Good morning, friends. Today I will discuss about hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis and how hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis is related to the menstrual cycle. First, we have to understand what is hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis.
Hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis.
So, from the name itself, it is very clear that there is hypothalamus, there is pituitary, and there is ovary. There is a link between these three parts. One is hypothalamus, another is pituitary, and another is ovary. We know that hypothalamus is present in our brain.
So, hypothalamus is present in our brain.
Within this hypothalamus, there is a special type of cells called gonadotropin
releasing hormone expressing neurons.
So what I've said, within the hypothalamus there is a special kind of cell which is called gonadotropin releasing hormone expressing neurons. What is the function of these cells? From the name itself, it is very clear that gonadotropin releasing hormone expressing neurons secrete a hormone called gonadotropin releasing hormone. So we can say that from hypothalamus, gonadotropin releasing hormones are secreted because the cells gonadotropin releasing hormone expressing neurons are present within the hypothalamus. So for easy communication, we can say that from hypothalamus a hormone is released which is called gonadotropin releasing hormone.
Gonadotropin releasing hormone.
This gonadotropin releasing hormone comes directly into the pituitary gland. Now, the pituitary, we all know that the pituitary gland is having two major lobes. One is anterior part of the pituitary, which is called anterior pituitary, and another is posterior pituitary. So there are two lobes of the pituitary gland. One is anterior pituitary, and another is posterior pituitary. We will not discuss about posterior pituitary. We will focus our discussion mainly on the anterior pituitary. So from the hypothalamus, the hormone which is released is called gonadotropin releasing hormone. This hormone comes directly into the anterior pituitary. From hypothalamus, the gonadotropin releasing hormone comes directly into the anterior pituitary through by means of a system of blood vessels. This portal system is called hypophyseal
portal system.
What I have said, from hypothalamus to pituitary, this hypothalamus and pituitary are very closely located, and they are connected by a system of blood vessels, by a system of portal system, which is called hypothalamic hypophyseal portal system. How is this system of blood vessels? How is this portal system? This portal system begins with capillaries and ends in capillaries. Which connect both hypothalamus and anterior pituitary. So the gonadotropin releasing hormone which are released from hypothalamus comes directly into the anterior pituitary. When the hormone reaches anterior pituitary, this anterior pituitary gets stimulated. And when the anterior pituitary gets stimulated, it releases another hormone which is called follicle stimulating hormone, which is called FSH, that is follicle stimulating hormone. So when hypothalamus releases gonadotropin releasing hormone, it comes directly into the anterior pituitary. When it reaches the anterior pituitary gets stimulated and in turn releases another hormone which is called follicle stimulating hormone. Now, is it clear to everyone? Okay. Now, more is the release of follicle stimulating hormone, more will be the maturation of the ovarian follicles. More is the maturation of ovarian follicles. So from the name itself, it is clear that ovarian follicles resides within the ovary. So these are the part of the ovary.
So mood is the release of follicle stimulating hormone from the anterior pituitary. Mood is the maturation of ovarian follicles within the ovary. And mood is the maturation of the ovarian follicles within the ovaries. Mood is the production of a hormone called estrogen. Estrogen. This estrogen is produced by the ovarian follicles present within the ovary. Because these ovarian follicles contain a special type of cells called granulosa cells, and these releases the hormone estrogen. So mood is the production of follicle stimulating hormone, mood is the maturation of ovarian follicles, and mood is the maturation of ovarian follicles, mood is the release of estrogen. So this estrogen helps in the this estrogen acts on the uterus and helps in the thickening of the uterine lining. This estrogen helps in the thickening of uterine lining, thickening of the endometrium. It is called endometrium because it gives a cushion if fertilization takes place. If fertilization takes place, it will give a cushion to the forming embryo. It will give a cushion to the embryo. So thickening of the uterine lining is very important. Thickening of the endometrium is very important. And who will take care of this thickening of this endometrium? This hormone estrogen. Mood is the release of estrogen. Mood will be the thickening of this endometrium. Is it clear? Now, when the level of estrogen gradually rises, it will reach in a cycle of 28 days, menstrual cycle of 28 days. Ideal menstrual cycle is of 28 days. There could be variations of 7 to 10 days and it is normal. But we will consider ideal cycle of 28 days. So if we consider a cycle of 28 days, if this is day 1, if this is day 1 and if it is day 28, the middle of the cycle is day 14. The middle of the cycle is day 14. And when it reaches day 14, the level of estrogen is maximum. When the level of estrogen is maximum, it directly gives a positive feedback to the anterior pituitary. When the level of estrogen is maximum, it directly gives a positive feedback to the anterior pituitary that releases another hormone immediately. And that is called luteinizing hormone. So, when the estrogen level gets maximum on day 14, it gives a signal, it gives a positive feedback to the anterior pituitary that my level has become maximum, you immediately release another hormone which is called luteinizing hormone. And immediately the anterior pituitary will release this luteinizing hormone and there will be a sharp rise of the level of luteinizing hormone. What is the function of this luteinizing hormone? When this hormone, luteinizing hormone, gets released and the ovarian follicles have already got matured with the follicle stimulating hormone. Now, when luteinizing hormone is released and there is a sharp rise in the luteinizing hormone, the ovarian follicles open up. The ovarian follicles will break and the ovum from the ovarian follicles will come out. And this is called ovulation. Now, at the same time, this estrogen will give a negative feedback to the hypothalamus to stop the production of this gonadotropin releasing hormone. Why? Because if this gonadotropin, if the release of this gonadotropin hormone is not stopped, then what will happen? More follicle stimulating hormone will be produced and there will be more production of estrogen, which is not necessary. There should be a balance maintained between this cycle, between this axis. So whenever there is a secretion of luteinizing hormone, there will be a release of the egg cell or the ovum from the ovarian follicles. Now, these ruptured ovarian follicles, are called corpus luteum. Now, this corpus luteum will start producing another hormone which is called progesterone. This corpus luteum will start producing another hormone, this is called progesterone. And progesterone helps make the uterine lining in such a way that it will help in the nourishment of the embryo if at all fertilization takes place. Clear? So from this, what we have learned, that estrogen is necessary for maintaining the thickness of the uterine lining or the endometrium. Is it clear? Now, I will discuss about the menstrual cycle and how menstrual cycle is related to this hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis. What I have said, ideally the menstrual cycle is of 28 days. If this is day 1, this is day 28. variations of 7 to 10 days. There could be variations, but we will consider the ideal phase of 28 days cycle. Now, what is the middle of the cycle? This is day 14. Now, when we see that the cycle gets longer in length or shorter in length, it is because of the first phase. It is because of the first phase. It is not because of the second phase. Estrogen maximum, estrogen. Estrogen plays a major role. First, you have to understand the first phase of the menstrual cycle. The estrogen takes the major lead. And in the second phase of the menstrual cycle, progesterone takes the major lead. Progesterone. This is called follicular phase. This day 1 to 14 is called follicular phase. Follicular phase. Why it is called follicular phase? Because of the maturation of the ovarian follicles. And this phase, from day 14 to day 28, it is called luteal phase. Luteal phase. Why this is called luteal phase? This is called luteal phase. The name of this phase comes from the corpus luteum. From the corpus luteum. I will come into the details of that. And day 14, when actual ovulation takes place, it is called ovulation phase. Ovulation phase. Now, within this follicular phase from day 1 to day 14, day 1 to day 5 is called the menstrual phase. Why? Because here actual menstruation takes place. Ideally, it is for 5 days, but there could be variations. Some women can have 3 days of menstrual phase. Some people can have 4 days of menstrual phase. But ideally, it is for 5 days. Now, on day 1, on the start of the menstrual cycle, the level of estrogen and follicle stimulating hormones are at its minimum. Why? On the start of the menstrual cycle, the level of follicle stimulating hormone is its minimum. When follicle stimulating hormone is at the low level, the maturation of the ovarian follicle will also not be there, and so there will be no release of estrogen, so estrogen level will also be low. Now, with the release of follicle stimulating hormone, gradual release of follicle stimulating hormone from the anterior pituitary, what will happen? The ovarian follicles will get gradually matured, and with the maturation of the ovarian follicles, they will release this estrogen. So the level of estrogen will start gradually increasing as the day approaches towards day 14. So on day 13, what we will see? We will see there will be a high level of estrogen. And on day 14, what will happen? The level of estrogen will be at its maximum. So maximum estrogen level will be at day 14. So when the level of estrogen reaches its maximum on day 14, it will give a positive feedback, as I have discussed earlier. It will give a positive feedback to the anterior pituitary that immediately release your luteinizing hormone. Then the anterior pituitary will release the luteinizing hormone, and there will be a sharp rise in the luteinizing hormone on day 14. So on day 14, what we will see? The level of luteinizing hormone will be and this luteinizing hormone helps in the rupture of the matured ovarian follicles, and the ovum will come out of it. So on day 14, actual ovulation takes place, and this is called ovulation phase. Now what will happen? Once the follicles gets ruptured, these ruptured ovarian follicles are called corpus luteum. What I have said, these ruptured ovarian follicles are called corpus luteum. Now, this corpus luteum will now start producing another hormone called progesterone. This progesterone will help to make the uterine lining in such a way that it can nourish the embryo if at all fertilization takes place. So, as the day advances, the level of progesterone will get increased. Now, if the fertilization does not take place, what will happen? The ovum, the egg cell, can stay for 24 hours only. The worm can stay for only 24 hours only within the fallopian tube. If fertilization does not take place by this time, what will happen? The egg cell will get disintegrated. The ovum will get disintegrated. And once the ovum gets disintegrated, the egg cell gets disintegrated, what will happen? The formation of progesterone will immediately stop. The formation of estrogen will immediately stop. So what will happen? The endometrium, there will be a gradual decrease in the level of progesterone and estrogen. And on day 25, we will see that the level of estrogen and progesterone comes to its minimum. And on day 28, what will happen? The actual menstruation takes place. The endometrium will break down and comes out through the vagina with blood. So this is for menstruation. Then again the cycle of 1 to 5 days of menstrual phase starts and the cycle continues. Now, if the cycle of 28 days gets longer and longer, and if it cross 35 days, every month if it is found that the menstruation takes place after 35 days, we will call this as oligomenorrhea. Oligomenorrhea. This is called oligomenorrhea. Now, what is the cause of this oligomenorrhea? Why the cycle is gradually increased from 28 days and it crosses 35 days? This is because what I have said, in a cycle of 28 days, the luteal phase from 14 to day 28 will not change in its length. It will change from day 1 to day 14, that is the follicular phase will change. Either it will be greater or it will be shorter. But this phase, this luteal phase is always fixed. Why this is so? If the follicle stimulating hormone, if the release of the follicle stimulating hormone is slow or it is not up to the mark, then what will happen? It will take more time for the ovarian follicles to get mature. And if it gets more time to the ovarian follicles to get mature, this duration, this follicular phase will get increased. So ultimately the cycle of 28 days will get increased. And if it is increased in such a way that the total cycle cross 28 days, so 28, if it is cross 35 days, we will call it as oligomenorrhea. Clear? Now, what we have seen in case of oligomenorrhea, there are amples of reasons, there are lots of reasons for oligomenorrhea. But one of the reasons is that low level of follicle stimulating hormone, which ultimately leads to low level of estrogen. Why? Because lower is the level of follicle stimulating hormone, lower will be the maturation of the ovarian follicles, and lower will be the release of estrogen. So lesser will be the release of estrogen. So we can say that in case of oligomenorrhea, the estrogen level will be on its lower side. Now, if there is a heavy bleeding, which is called menorrhagia, menorrhagia means there is a heavy menstrual flow, what is the cause of that? We have already discussed that the role of estrogen is to make the endometrium or the uterine lining thicker. So, if more is the release of follicle stimulating hormone, what will happen? More will be the release of estrogen from the ovarian follicles. Now, more is the release of estrogen, this endometrium will get more and more thicker. So, whenever if fertilization does not take place, what will happen the day when this endometrium will break down? What will happen? Lots of blood and menstrual content will come out. There will be a heavy menstrual bleeding, and that is called menorrhagia. So we can say that there are lots of reasons for menorrhagia, tons of reasons for menorrhagia. But one of the reasons is that higher level of estrogen. What I have said? So for oligomenorrhea, what we have seen? That the level of estrogen is low. And for menorrhagia, what we have seen? The level of estrogen is high. Now, if we give phytoestrogens, what are phytoestrogens? Phyto means plants. And the plants are having some compounds which are almost similar to that of the estrogen. They are structurally almost similar to that of estrogen. And the estrogen, where the estrogen binds to its receptor, estrogens have their specific receptors, and these phytoestrogens, if they are consumed by humans, they will move and bind into the estrogen receptors of our body. Clear? So these phytoestrogens, which are obtained from plants, if a woman consumes that, what will happen? They will work like estrogens, and they will share the same estrogenic receptors. clear? Now, phytoestrogens are structurally almost similar to estrogen, but they are much weaker than estrogen. What I have said? They are much weaker than estrogen. So, these phytoestrogens are having two types of properties. Phytoestrogens come from plants because phytogen is plants. They are having two different properties. What are that? One is estrogenic properties. Estrogenic property. Property. And another is anti-estrogenic property. Anti-estrogenic property. What I have said? Phytoestrogens are having two different types of property. One is estrogenic property and another is completely different, that is anti-estrogenic property. But how this is possible? It is possible because phytoestrogens acts like regulator. What happens when we feel very hot? We turn the fan faster by a regulator. So what will happen? We just increase the speed of the fan. But when we feel cold, for that what we will do? We decrease the speed of the fan by using that regulator. So phytoestrogen also works like that. When the estrogen level is at its maximum, phytoestrogen works by anti-estrogenic property. But when the estrogen level in the body gets reduced and it is minimum, then phytoestrogen acts like estrogen and shows its estrogenic property. Now I am explaining how is it possible. Suppose these are the estrogen receptors of the body. These are the estrogen receptors of the body. Now, if the estrogen level is low in a woman, the estrogen will come and bind to some of its receptors, and majority of the receptors will keep vacant. Now, if we consume phytoestrogen, what will happen? Phytoestrogens are structurally similar to estrogen, and they will come and bind to the vacant estrogenic receptors. So, what will happen? It will show estrogenic property. So in case of oligomenorrhea, what we have seen, the estrogen levels are low in the woman. So what will happen? The estrogens will bind some of the receptors present in their body. Now if she consume phytoestrogen, the phytoestrogen come and binds to the vacant estrogen receptors, and the oligomenorrhea will be taken care of. Yes. If it crosses 35 days, it may not come to 28 days as ideal, but it will come to 30 days because phytoestrogens are weaker than estrogens. Is it clear? But the cycle will come into a normal pace. It will come into a normal range. Clear? Now think the opposite scenario. If the woman is having excess of estrogen production, then what will happen? All the estrogen will come and bind to all the receptors, estrogen receptors. And this will cause menorrhagia. Now, because we have to reduce, to take care of menorrhagia, we have to reduce the effect of this estrogen. Now, if the woman consume phytoestrogen, what will happen? Phytoestrogen compete with this estrogen and goes faster than estrogen and bind with the estrogen receptors. Once the phytoestrogen binds to the estrogen receptors, estrogen cannot come and bind to this, their receptors. And what will happen? The effect of the estrogen will get reduced because estrogen are much stronger in activity than the phytoestrogens. So the effect of estrogen will come reduced because the phytoestrogens are now binding these estrogen receptors, and estrogen itself cannot go and bind to its receptor. So the effect of estrogen will get reduced and the menorrhagia will get controlled. Is it clear to all? So this is the role of phytoestrogens and how phytoestrogen works as a regulator. Hope this is clear to everyone. If you have any queries, you can clear it out from me. You can ask questions. Is it clear? Okay, thank you.